Dear students, now we are going to study the thermodynamic principle involved in the reduction of metallic oxide into metal. That means earlier in the reduction process we have seen iron ore reduced using carbon and then reduction using hydrogen, carbon monoxide, other metals, all those things we have seen. But how to choose a suitable reducing agent for a particular metal oxide? That can be clearly known from the thermodynamic principle. After all, what is a reduction? When a metal oxide, say MxOy, let the molecular formula for the metal oxide be MxOy. When the metal oxide get reduced, it will become metal and oxygen will go off, O2. We will be writing O2, therefore I can write Y atoms of O are present here, it has to be divided and I have to add 2. Therefore, 2y molecules of MxY, if I write, it will yield Y and Y get cancelled, O2. And how many M atoms will be formed? 2x by Y atoms will be formed. Here, metal oxide is reduced to metal. In order for the reduction of metal oxide into metal, naturally the oxygen has to be taken. The oxygen has to be taken out. Which one will take out the oxygen? Some reducing agent has to take out. Let me say carbon is the reducing agent. The carbon will take up oxygen, may become carbon dioxide. If carbon can take up this oxygen as carbon dioxide, metal oxide will become metal. On the other hand, if carbon can take oxygen to become carbon monoxide, again, consumption of oxygen, therefore the reduction of metal oxide into metal will take place. Again, carbon monoxide formed may act as a reducing agent. It may take oxygen to become carbon dioxide. In all these cases, consumption of oxygen is consumed, consumption. So since it is being consumed, it may act as a reducing agent. Carbon monoxide can act as a reducing agent. But whether such removal of oxygen by these elements possible for the metal oxide, that can be known from thermodynamic principle. Let me balance the equation first. 2 oxygen, therefore 2. O, it has to be even number, therefore 2. Totally 4 oxygen atoms, 2 CO2. So if we couple equation 1 with 2, 3 or 4, and if we find that it is feasible based on thermodynamic factors. So the feasibility of the reaction is tested in terms of enthalpy to start with. If it is negative, the reaction will be feasible, exothermic reaction. Otherwise, the delta S can be positive entropy change, measure of randomness. If the randomness increases, then also it is feasible. Both are favorable factors, and both these favorable factors are present in a particular reaction, then delta G will be equal to delta H minus P delta S. Here, delta S positive, delta H negative, therefore negative plus negative, it will give negative value. Definitely, when delta H is negative, Gibbs free energy is negative, the reaction will be feasible. Otherwise, depending upon which one dominates, if one of the factors is not favorable, depending upon the values of delta H and P delta S, whether the reaction will be feasible or not, we'll be finding out. That may be the thermodynamic principle behind the reduction of metal oxide into metal. And how to get delta G then? Jellingham assumed that the reactions, reduction reactions of metal oxide, the oxidation of metal into metal oxide is a reversible reaction. That means decomposition also. So he assumed that oxidation of an element is a reversible reaction. Oxidation of a metal into metal oxide and again conversion of metal oxide into metal and oxygen is a reversible reaction. By assuming these reactions as reversible, he calculated delta G value for the reactants. Delta is equal to minus delta G is Gibbs free energy minus RT ln Kp. So this is the equation for Gibbs free energy change, R gas constant, T temperature, Kp equilibrium constant. So by knowing the equilibrium constant value, temperature, it is possible for us to calculate delta G value. And for different metals with oxygen, he calculated the values of delta G. And he plotted the delta G value against temperature. Thereby he has got the graph. That is known as Ellingham diagram. Using such diagram, it is possible for us to predict whether the reactant is feasible or not. Let me draw Ellingham diagram roughly. I cannot draw as per scale, but anyhow, I may try to give approximate idea, and you can refer from the actual graph which is found in your book. Your book may give the actual graph. Let me give approximate. Delta G is equal to minus RT ln Kp. Kilojoule per mole of oxygen. Kilojoule per mole of oxygen. So we are plotting delta G here and temperature in degree Celsius. Remember, in degree Celsius. In our discussion, we will be going in for Kelvin. But here it is given in degree Celsius. Here it is kilojoule per mole of oxygen. The graph, starting with different elements. For different elements, the relationship between delta G naught and temperature can be plotted. What are the different elements? We start with calcium. And before that, in what way the delta G naught is mentioned here? It is started with 1000 minus 1200 kilojoule per mole. And it reaches 0, minus 100, plus 100, plus 200 like that. So minus 1200 to minus 1100, minus 1000, likewise it goes. I am not going to draw the graph as per scale. Here 200 degree Celsius, 400, 600, up to 2400 degree Celsius will go. Alright. Let me start with calcium. Calcium, when reacts with oxygen, become calcium oxide. It is a reversible reaction. The delta G naught value is calculated for 1 mole of oxygen. So the graph for calcium goes like this. Maybe towards the end, that is increase, calcium. And then magnesium. Calcium, magnesium. And then aluminium. Then we are going in for D block element. First series of D block elements. Scandium, titanium, vanadium, chromium, manganese, iron, cobalt, nickel, copper, zinc. these are the first series of D-blocklimers. In that, we are going to start with chromium, manganese, iron, nickel, copper, zinc. For all these elements, all these six elements, we are going to draw the graph. So for chromium, the graph goes like this. Approximate graph, chromium. Manganese little bit lower. Iron, chromium, manganese, iron, nickel, nickel, copper, iron, nickel and copper. Next to that, zinc comes here, goes like this, zinc. And then we have mercury and silver. All these metals on oxidation at different temperatures, we are finding out delta G and the graph is drawn. For example, calcium plus oxygen gives CaO, 2CaO. Magnesium plus oxygen gives MgO, 2MgO, therefore 2. Aluminium with oxygen gives Al2O3. But remember, only one mole of oxygen has to be written because delta G naught is equal to minus RT ln Kp kilojoule per mole for 1 mole of oxygen. So it should be 1 mole of oxygen. Definitely here also we should get only 2 oxygen atoms. Here already 3 we have, it has to be divided. Then we can add 2. It becomes O2. 3 already we have, it can be 3 divided by 3, get cancelled, we will be getting O2. How many aluminium atoms then? 4 by 3 aluminium here. Because 2 aluminium here, we have multiplied by 2, therefore 4 by 3. 4 by 3 Al plus O2 gives 2 by 3, 2 into 2, 4 by 3 aluminium, and then 3 get cancelled, O2. Manganese plus O2, MnO2, MnO or MnO2. Chromium plus oxygen, chromic oxide, Cr2O3, it is similar to Al2O3. Therefore, the same formula applies, 4 by 3 here, O2, 2 by 3. Likewise, iron becomes iron oxide, zinc becomes zinc oxide, nickel becomes nickel oxide, copper oxide, mercury oxide, silver oxide. All those things we may guess. I need not write all those things. All these reactions are in equilibrium. This graph is said to be Ellingham diagram. Ellingham diagram. So what we are going to know from this? The interpretation or observation of Ellingham diagram we should know. Only then we can appreciate Ellingham diagram well. Alright. So during metal oxide formation, whenever metal becomes metal oxide, we find positive slope. The slope is found to be positive. It moves in this direction. Positive slope. If it goes like this, negative slope. What is the meaning of positive slope? When temperature is increased, delta G naught is also increasing. It goes like this. So the positive slope for the conversion of metal to metal oxide indicates that, we will be knowing that delta G naught is equal to delta H minus T delta S. I have given already. If it is positive, the meaning is T delta S value is positive, therefore delta S is negative. This equation is of the form Y is equal to MX plus C. In X axis we have T. Y intercept is enthalpy. Slope is delta S. We can get positive slope only when delta S become negative. How can it be negative then? Delta S, how can it be negative, or what for it become negative? Solid metal consumes oxygen gas and becoming alumina solid. Solid metal consumes gas becomes solid. When gas is being consumed to become solid, entropy decreases, randomness decreases. Whenever a solid becomes liquid, entropy increases, randomness. Liquid part molecules can move here and there. When it becomes gas, it can move far away. Therefore, randomness still decreases. Whereas here, a gas becomes solid. One mole of gas is consumed, and therefore entropy decreases. When entropy decreases, delta S becomes negative. And therefore, for all the metals, we are finding positive slope. All right? Then, regarding carbon to become carbon monoxide, the graph goes like this. It cuts almost all metals. Carbon to carbon monoxide. Carbon to become carbon monoxide. Two oxygen, therefore 2CO, 2C. Here, we find negative slope, showing that delta S value positive. For the conversion of carbon to carbon monoxide, slope is negative, positive. Only if it is positive, slope is negative. This is possible only when delta S is positive. So here delta S is positive. Why? Here carbon is a solid, but oxygen is a gas. When it is consumed, we are getting a gas. Carbon monoxide is a gas. So randomness increases. One mole of gas is becoming two moles of gas. Therefore, randomness increases. Once the randomness increases, delta S will be positive. Once delta S is positive value, it will be negative slope. The value will be negative. Y is equal to mx plus c, m will become negative. So negative slope we are getting. That is the reason behind that. And one more interpretation. So what is the first, next interpretation, let me go, third interpretation. When temperature is increased, observation. When temperature is increased, the delta G naught value decreases. Negative value decreases. Negative value decreases. That means delta G increases. Negative value decreases and becomes positive value towards the end. As long as delta S G value become negative, it is more stable. When delta G value decreases, when delta G value become positive, it becomes unstable. So, when the temperature increases higher and higher, the metallic oxide becomes less negative, and above a particular temperature, it may become positive value and becomes unstable. And in certain cases, we find a sharp change in the graph. It may be because of the phase change. Until then, it may be in solid phase and it may become molten stage, or it may get evaporated, may become gaseous state. It is because of such phase transition we find sharp change here. So these are the four observations we have seen. What are the four observations? First one, for all the graphs in general, we find a positive slope. But the equation for delta G is delta X equal to T delta S. As long as delta G is positive value, as long as delta G S is positive value, the slope should be negative. As long as delta S is positive, the slope should be negative. Because it is of the expression delta S equal to minus T delta S. When it is a positive value, the whole value will begin negative. Therefore, slope will be negative. But it is not so. Therefore, delta S is negative. Therefore, delta S is negative. For the conversion of all the metal into metal oxide. The reason is, gas becomes solid. That's what we have given. First point. Second point. For the conversion of carbon into carbon monoxide, we find negative slope. We find negative slope as it is. So negative slope means for C is equal to CO. The reason is delta S is positive. Why so? It is because the number of gaseous moles of product get increased, randomness get increased, delta S becomes positive. Then third idea, when the temperature is increased, the metal oxide value, negative value get reduced, showing that the stability of metal oxide is getting reduced. When delta S G value is more negative, it is more stable. Stability decreased. And the fourth observation, here we find these sort of changes. These sort of changes, sharp change may be due to phase change. These are all the observations of Ellingen diagram. Now, we should find the application of Ellingen diagram. What are the applications? Very important. We are going to apply this diagram for reducing the metal oxide into metal. Only for this purpose we are going to apply this Ellingen diagram. So that is the main application. So suitable reducing agent, how to choose? That's what we are going to see now. You see, conversion of silver into silver oxide, Ag plus O2 gives Ag2O. Hg plus O2 gives HgO. In these graphs, in this part, we are getting delta G value becoming more positive than negative. When it becomes positive, spontaneous decomposition, no reducing agent is needed. It is unstable. Those metal oxides are unstable. Silver oxide or mercuric oxide, Ag2O or HgO, they get decomposed of their own, no need for any reducing agent. That's why in auto reduction method we have seen HgS, cinnabar, when it is burnt in air, it becomes Hg plus SO2. Auto reduction. Why so? The mercury which forms mercuric oxide get decomposed, that's all. The second application, how to find the suitable reducing agent? In general, the metal which is present below can reduce the metal which is present at the top. This is general idea. Why so? What is the reason? Here, calcium oxide is more stable than magnesium oxide, as the delta G value is more negative. And therefore, calcium can take up oxygen from magnesium oxide and forms calcium oxide, reducing magnesium. Aluminium can reduce chromium oxide into chromium. That's what we have seen in aluminothermic process. Aluminium reduced chromium oxide, chromic oxide into chromium. Whereas such reduction is not possible for chromium to reduce aluminium. The reason is alumina is stable than chromic oxide. So aluminium can take up oxygen from chromic oxide to become aluminium oxide. Likewise, magnesium, calcium, etc., those oxides cannot be reduced by aluminium. Aluminium is above, alumina is less stable when compared to magnesium oxide and aluminium oxide. Therefore, aluminium can reduce chromic oxide to chromium, but aluminium cannot reduce magnesium oxide or calcium oxide, because aluminium oxide is less stable than these oxides. It cannot take up oxygen from this. That can easily be, that is about choosing a particular reducing agent. That is the main application of Ellingen diagram. And then, below 1000 Kelvin. It is in Celsius, below 1000 Kelvin, maybe 1000 Kelvin means in degree Celsius 727 degree Celsius, the carbon line cuts iron line. That means the carbon line should be like this. It is higher drawn, little above. At that temperature, it cuts iron line. What does it mean? Below that temperature, carbon monoxide is more stable than iron oxide. Iron becomes iron oxide, FeO. And below 1000 Kelvin, below 1000 Kelvin, the carbon monoxide line is above iron ferrous oxide line, FeO line, FeO. This is carbon CO. This line comes here. And above this, carbon can act as reducing agent because carbon monoxide becomes more stable. Below that, it cannot reduce as it is above FeO line. Therefore, based upon this diagram, we can decide at what temperature it can act as reducing agent also. For example, above this 1000 Kelvin, iron becomes iron oxide, FeO, and the delta G value, or delta G naught value is found to be minus 350 kilojoule per mole. And the carbon oxygen, it is predicted from the graph. When we cut this at this point, the carbon oxygen to become carbon monoxide, delta G naught value is found to be minus 480 kilojoule per mole. That we are referring from the graph. At this temperature, what is the delta G naught value? We find this value. Whether carbon can act as reducing agent? Yes, it can. That's what we have seen. Above this temperature, it can act as reducing agent. How? Let's see. When we reverse the first reaction, FeO gives 2Fe plus O2. Delta G naught is equal to plus 350 kilojoule. Because as per the Ellingham diagram, for that particular temperature, the delta G naught value is found to be plus 350 kilojoule. When we sum up these two equations, let it be 1, 2, 3. If we sum up these two equations, the net reaction will be FeO plus 2C. Oxygen and oxygen get cancelled, gives 2FeO plus 2C gives 2Fe plus 2CO. Delta G naught is equal to addition of these two. When you add these two, it will become minus 130 kilojoule per mole. Delta G naught value will be minus 130 kilojoule per mole if we sum up these two values. So for the reduction of 2 moles of ferrous oxide by 2 moles of carbon, the value is this much. For 1 mole, the value will be delta G naught is equal to minus 65 kilojoule per mole. So this reaction is feasible. Carbon can act as reducing agent after crossing that 1000 Kelvin. That's what we are getting from Ellingham diagram. So the application of Ellingham diagram is to find out the suitable reducing agent. Certain metallic oxides, they don't need any reducing agent because they are in the upper part. Chromic oxide can be reduced by aluminium.
because aluminium is lower part in the Lingam diagram, and anything which is at the lower part can reduce the one which is at the upper part. So aluminium cannot reduce magnesium oxide or calcium oxide. When you find the graph of carbon giving carbon monoxide, it cuts the line, FeFuO line, at about 1000 Kelvin. After that, carbon monoxide is more stable and carbon starts to reduce ferrous oxide to iron. And that's what we have seen by referring the graph. At the graph, at a particular temperature, we have referred, and the values are found to be this much. At last, carbon, when it reduces ferrous oxide, the delta G naught value is found to be negative. Therefore, the reaction is feasible. That is about application of Elegant diagram. Now, what are the limitations then? It has its own application, but it has its own demerits also. What is it? The rate of the reaction cannot be predicted. And then, possibilities of other reactions, side reactions which are taking place, cannot be known from this Elegant diagram. And then the assumption of Elegant diagram is that it is in equilibrium. All these reactions are in equilibrium. That is the assumption. It need not be always true. So these are all the limitations. One, rate cannot be determined. The possibility of other reactions cannot be known. And then the delta G value is based on the equilibrium concept, but it need not be always true. Thank you.